Yeah. Nathan Hunter. I'm glad you've chosen to worship Jesus with us today. I want to share just one thing with you before we get started to kind of set our heart and set our mind in the right place before we start to sing and worship. And it comes from James 4:8, which says, "Come near to God, and He will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." As we enter the light of Jesus, and it gives testimony to our heart and life, which in His perfect light reveals the sin that is in our lives and gives us the choice to either run back into the sin and stay in the darkness, believing the dark way is best, or confess it and find forgiveness for our sin, where it says that Jesus will separate sin as far as the east is from the west. It is gone. It is forgiven. And then we showing that we put our faith in Him, which is best for us. There is some tension involved in this process, but the result of choosing His way and being near Him leads to peace. And it's the right kind of peace. So I encourage you that as we go to a time of just opening in prayer this morning, that you would ask God for forgiveness, that you would ask God to heal you, to restore you, and to make the relationship right again with Him. So let's pray together.
Yeah, and even invite you to just talk to Him on your own right now, just for a few seconds here, a few moments. Come before Him with thanksgiving. Ask for forgiveness for your sin. Thank you, Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit. Jesus, thank you that you are here. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you can speak to us today. Help us to come into the light that is you, to give testimony to who you are. Come redeem, come save, come heal. Do what only you can do today. Jesus, we give you full freedom. You have the power and the ability to do marvelous and wonderful things. Come and do them inside of our heart and inside of our life, in our relationships. Just may you be glorified in what we do and say today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all stand together.
Redeemed by the blood of I haven't had the privilege of meeting you before, my name is Nate Kemper. I'm the lead pastor here at Now Then Alliance Church. Love that we gather together each week to celebrate Jesus. We'll continue doing that here in a moment through song by giving back to God some of what he's blessed us with, studying God's word, and then we get the privilege today from hearing from one of our international workers as well, and so we're excited about that. Before that, just a reminder of why we existed as a church. We exist to equip people to find life and faith in Christ, and believe we do that best as we connect with each other, as we grow in our own relationship with God and encourage others to do the same, and as we participate in what God is doing in our lives and in the world around us. And there's a variety of opportunities coming up for you to be able to do those things. One of those, a growth opportunity, is called the Growth Track. That's something, a class that Pastor Nathan and I lead on Wednesday nights. It's a four-week-long class where we talk through how God has worked in our life, how he's wired us each uniquely and individually, how he wants to use us in the world that we live in and in the church that we belong to. And we'd love to have you be a part of that. If you don't understand those things in your life, your purpose, how God's wired you, created you, if you want to just meet some other people that are in that journey or engage with us at a deeper level at the church, we'd love to have you for that. That starts this Wednesday night at 7. You can talk to either Nathan or I if you want to join. You can show up at 7 if you want to join. Or the best way is you can put Growth Track, either check the box or write it on the back, and we'll make sure to follow up with you with other details about that as well. This card, also a great way to connect with us or allow us to connect with you, particularly through prayer. You can let us know how we can be praying for you on the back of this card. If you're engaging with us digitally, you can do that via the contact form on our website. We'd love to join you in praying for the things you hope to see God do in your life as well. Another step to participate or take the next step in engagement here at our church would be through membership. And if you've got questions about that or just want to know more about our church, what we believe, our values, meet some of our leaders, great opportunity for that is a membership lunch we've got coming up next Sunday after the second service, around noon next Sunday down in the cafe. It'll be a great time to do any of that. We'd love to have you there. If you're interested in membership or have questions about our church, great time to come and learn about that or start the process of membership with that. And then just another final reminder on a growth opportunity coming up is in the fall, Pastor Bruce and I are leading a trip to Israel, a tour of the Holy Lands. There's still a lot of opportunities to sign up for the trip, but the price increases like 9 days from now. And so you can save a little bit of money if you sign up in the next 9 days. If you've got questions about that, Pastor Bruce is the best way to direct it, though I'd be happy to try and answer questions about that as well. Well, like I said, we get the privilege of hearing from one of our international workers. Rose Friedel's been in town for a month and a half or so and still in town for a few more weeks. And she's going to come share with us about what some of her recent work in Taiwan has been like and how you can join and support her in those efforts.
Good morning, everyone. Yes, my name is Rose Friedel, and my parents, Scott and Lois Friedel, have been bringing me to Now Then here since I was about 5 years old. Today, I'm also honored to say that my grandparents are here supporting me. And just to start off, I wanted to show off my t-shirt. This is actually the Taiwan flag, and it says Taiwan in their Mandarin and their characters that they write in. And before I start, I just wanted to share that I've been in Taiwan for about 6 years now. And 4 years ago, a small team and myself moved from the capital down more towards the rural part of Taiwan to pioneer a new location to do missions out of. And some of the missions that we've been able to do is to go into schools and teach English. We've been able to go to the library and community centers to teach English, as well as one-on-one personal development in relationship with some of the locals. And before I start sharing my prayer requests and what God is doing in Taiwan, I wanted you guys to watch this short video just to get your mindset into what Taiwan looks like, what I see and what I hear every day. Because as you can imagine, it's very different than what I see and hear in Now Then every day. And so just watch the video. It will go pretty fast. It's about a minute and a half. And towards the end, there are some firecrackers. It's how they weird off their ghosts or evil spirits. So I don't want anyone to be afraid, but just be warned that at the end there's some loud firecrackers. Other than that, just take a look at the video and I'll share more in a sec.
Thank you.
Now that you all have your mindset in what I see and what I hear every day, this is a weekly basis, at least that I would see. And of course, the trash truck is always fun. We do stand on the corner and hold our trash. And as soon as we hear it coming, we kind of just have to throw it in as the trash truck continues on its way. So it's quite a different experience than putting the big trash can at the end of the driveway once a week like we do out here and now then. But I just wanted to say thank you guys so much for your prayers and support, and also a few ways that you can continue to pray for me as I will be going back to Taiwan at the end of this month. Firstly, I just want to ask for prayer for my team. Like I mentioned, a small team. We're a team of four right now. And I ask for prayer that my team would grow. Not only grow in numbers, but also grow in unity and grow in strength together as we go out and do work together in the community. There's always more opportunities to serve, and people are always asking us to help them out. Sometimes it's Christian organizations to help evangelize. Sometimes it's teachers that need help teaching English. Whatever the case may be, our team is unfortunately not able to say yes to all these opportunities due to our numbers, that we're such a small team. But also that the things our team does together, I ask that it would be in unity as we go out and serve together in the community. As you see, they have their own idols and their own worship and their own gods there, that we as Christians want to go out and be a body of Christ and show them what that looks like. My second prayer request is for my friend's mom, actually. My friend and her sisters are Christians, and they actually live and work in the capital, but their mom lives really close to me, and I will actually go out and do activities with their mom. We enjoy hiking together. She often cooks meals for me, but due to the limitations of my language, I'm not always able to express or share the gospel to the deepest measures that I want to. So I ask that prayer that you guys would pray for her, that the Lord would speak and show up in her life in the way that he knows how. You can just call her Rose's Taiwanese mom, and the Lord will know exactly who you're talking about. As she takes care of me and she makes sure that I have things, like I said, even cooks meals for me sometimes. So I enjoy going on outings and spending that quality time with her, but I really just need the Lord to show up in the way that he knows how in her life. And my third prayer request is actually for the summer of 2022. Ever since 2019, things have been shut down and closed down in Taiwan. We haven't been able to do a lot of the outreaches that we would like or were planning or expecting to do. And so my prayer is that this summer coming up, that we could have an outreach, an English camp for the kids. Before, some of you may have seen, we used to have summer camps for 400 kids. We had multiple summer camps throughout the summer. And unfortunately, those have been shut down due to COVID. So I just ask for prayer, even this summer, if we can have a small summer camp, just a way to get out and be able to evangelize for the kids. Because when we have our own summer camp, we are allowed to share Bible stories. We can do skits and dramas about the Bible stories. We can pray for the kids before we have lunch with them at an all-day summer camp. And so we have a huge opportunity to share the gospel. We just need the means to do that. So that might be the government opening up Taiwan a little bit more, or schools allowing us to go in and host these summer camps. And lastly, because I cannot share everything, unfortunately, so I want to let you guys know that I do send out a quarterly newsletter. If you'd like to sign up, your email and your name, I will be in the back after the service, and through there you'll be able to keep updated on what God is doing in Taiwan and through my team in this rural area of Taiwan. So thank you all, and if you have any more questions, I'll be hanging out in the Koinia Cafe after the service.
I'm excited to have Rose here with us. It's worth your time to talk with her, encourage her, pray for her, sign up for her newsletter, figure out if you want to financially support her as an option as well. It's also worth your time whenever Taiwan opens back up and we're able to send teams to some of our alliance partners to come with us. So far, every time we've gone, we've gotten to spend time with Rose every time. I've spent more time with her in Taiwan than I've spent with her in America, which is awesome. And I'd encourage you to come and enjoy not just being able to hear those sounds, but some of them you can smell. Like, if you've been to Taiwan, you don't just hear a market, you smell a market, and you can learn what that smell is like as well. I want to pray for her. When I do, I'm also going to pray for our offering. That's something many of us choose to do, give back to God as an act of worship. If you're new or visiting here, we don't want you to feel any pressure or obligation to give, though if you'd like to join us in worshiping God in this way, you can do so through the offering box in the back, or you can anybody can give digitally as well. NowThenAlliance.org, there's a give tab there that can walk you through all of the instructions on that. Let's pray together. God, we are thankful for Rose and her heart to serve you where you've called her to right now in Taiwan. And we pray that as she gets ready to go back there, that you would send your spirit so powerfully with her that it would end up, through the result of the work you're doing, unite her team, that they would grow each more in their faith alongside anybody you may be calling to join them in the field of work there. We know that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And so we ask you, the Lord of the harvest, to send more workers there to help them, to deepen them together. We pray for her Taiwanese mom, that she would have sweet relationship with you, that she would have deep knowledge of you, that would come through a relationship she has with Rose, that would come through, despite language barriers, that it would come through a connection with your spirit alive in her and the way you've created her to worship you. And then we pray with hope and anticipation for when outreach events get to take a more normal form there in Taiwan, where it gets easier to gather crowds and to do so in a way where your truth gets to be represented, that as that would happen, that kids would find excitement about the reality of a God who loves them and comes to redeem and to save them, to bring them honor and to make them a part of their your family. And so we pray that there would be fruit for that, for your kingdom in the lives of individuals and the community there as they continue to minister. We pray as we take time now not to just give our requests to you, but our offerings to you, that they would be pleasing and acceptable to you as an act of worship, and that you would use these gifts to spread your love and to grow your kingdom in a world that could desperately use more of it. Pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's all stand together again as we continue in worshiping Jesus. Thank you. which bore the chosen
been spending the last couple of weeks talking about sin and what it looks like to be at war with sin. Talked 2 weeks ago about that general concept that we can't sign the peace treaty with sin in our lives, that it's crouching at our door and it only knows how to take control. And so if we're not fighting against it, it is no doubt controlling us. We saw that the first and primary way that we begin to battle against sin in our lives is confession. Acknowledging the truth and reality of sin, admitting to it, confessing to God and to others that it's true, and then stepping into a righteousness that comes not from our own actions and behaviors, but from what Christ has done for us. And then we've been in this plan where we're going to talk about the three things that we most have to battle against as it relates to sin. Last week, we talked about the devil, and that the devil is a liar, and that the number one way he tries to get us to sin is by deceiving us, trying to get us to believe that we can define good and evil ourselves instead of hearing it from God, that he tries to isolate us and lie to us, that the best spiritual warfare we have against him is the spiritual disciplines, to stay rooted in the truth of his word, to stay in relationship with God through prayer, to be in relationship and in truth to fight against what the devil is trying to do in our lives. Second in that fight is our flesh. We're going to spend today talking about the flesh and then next week talking about the world. All of that is from a statement that comes out of this book, Live No Lies by John Mark Comer, where when he talks about the fight against sin, he says this is really sin. Its strategy in our lives is to have deceptive ideas, that's the devil, that play to disordered desires, that's our flesh, that are normalized in a sinful world, that's the world. Deceptive ideas that play to disordered desires that are normalized in a sinful world. Today, we want to talk about how we war against our flesh. Paul, in Ephesians chapter 2, writing to believers, says this about us and our sin. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air. Note there already, he's talking about that the society and the devil. The spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient, that's the devil again. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. There's that middle word we're talking about today, flesh. In Greek, it's the word sarx, and it gets translated a few different ways in Scripture. There's a number of times it gets translated as body. So when we talk about like a marriage, two becoming one body, that's the word sarx or flesh. We use that still in today's language when we say something like it's their flesh and blood. We're talking about body. It's also used in the New Testament a few times to talk about ethnicity. To talk about your origin, your culture, your surroundings, that somebody's ethnicity would be their flesh that they're talking about. And then there's a third way. The third way is the one we're going to focus on today. It's where it's talking about our kind of animalistic cravings, the cravings of our body that are apart from God. In Romans, in a different place, Paul calls it our sinful passions. Peter calls it our corrupt desires. Author Eugene Peterson defined it as the corruption that sin has introduced into our very desires and instincts. It's the things we crave at an instinctual and desiring kind of level that sin has introduced to us. It's desires that sometimes we're supposed to be healthy and normalized that we've disordered and made unhealthy. And throughout Scripture, one of the most powerful desires, most often talked about, are sex and food. There's more laws about those in the Old Testament than almost any other thing. And in the New Testament, when the church is in disagreement in Acts chapter 15 about what we're supposed to require of believers who weren't Jewish to begin with, they boil it down to we're trying to make it as easy as possible for you. And so we're trying to boil down the whole law. And as we do so, it's be pure with your sexuality and your food. Boil down this understanding that our animalistic desires, our flesh, has great control over us. Maybe you've seen this play out in your own experience. I see it happen in my life consistently. I'll use even one of those food things as an example. About 10 days or so ago, our youth director, Josh, had bought some candy for his office. It was a large size bag of Mike and Ike's. And every time I went into his office, there was this open, large-size bag of Mike and Ike's. And so I'd reach my hand in and grab a few. And I'd eat some sugary goodness. I brought some. It's hard to open the bag and not want to eat some of them. But what I found over the course of the last 10 days was that meant more and more often I was making a trip to Josh's office. There were times where Josh wasn't in his office and I was making trips to Josh's office. At one point, I went into the administrative office first and I grabbed an empty cup, which most people use for coffee. And I walked into Josh's office to fill it so I didn't have to walk so much anymore. And I could sit in my own office just eating from the cup of Mike and Ike's that I had gathered. Just once or twice, the desire starts to grow, to become habit, to become in your thoughts, to become addictive. You start to orient what you're doing around the thing that you desire. The reality is in our world, we've adjusted values and principles to where we've decided our desires are what is most important. History, people used to live in cultures of authority, where we would do the things that external authorities like God or the Bible or tradition told us were more important. But today in the Western world, we often live by the value of authenticity, where we live from what our internal self desires and wants to do. Now, authority and authenticity both matter to God, but there's a kind of authenticity that we have become valuing in our culture that isn't the kind of authenticity God is talking about. This is played out not just in the ways that we see this behavior in our own society. We can trace this through the major philosophers of world history. For a long time, the major philosopher that everybody looked to was Augustine. He told us that our life was to be lived and ordered, and when we were doing something wrong, it was because our desires had become disordered. Here's what that would look like. You might love your job, and it's not bad to love your job. But if you start to love your career more than you love your kid, you have a disordered desire. And Augustine used to say, when we're having problems, it's because our desires have become disordered. It's not bad to love your child. You should. But you shouldn't love your child more than you love God. That's a disordered desire. And the world used to work in a way, cultures used to work in a way where we would look at our values and our desires and we would try to order them appropriately. And we would look to God or the Bible. We would look to tradition if we're doing it well. We would look to Christ first and foremost to figure out what that desire's ordering is supposed to be. And philosophy shifted. Freud came along and he started to say, no, the problem in your life isn't that your desires are disordered. The problem is in your life is that other people are trying to control your desires. That the best way to live is to live out your desires fully and not let anybody else constrain you anymore. Be free to be yourself. If you pay attention with just a cursory look at the world we live in today, you'll know what has won most recently. In the past, we were responsible for restraining our desires, our flesh. Today, instead, we argue that it's the right of all people to follow their desires, that that's how they would become their quote-unquote authentic and true self. And our happiness has become about feeling good, not about being good. About getting what we want, not about becoming the kind of people we're supposed to be. In our authority, too often, even in our own lives, for sure in our society, but too often even in our own lives, our authority has become ourself, our internal desires, or what Paul would call the flesh, instead of what it's supposed to be. And if we pause and think about it, we'll recognize that it's really easy to see that in other people. That their authority has become their desires instead of the Spirit of God in their lives. But it can be hard to see that in ourselves. I want to encourage you today, think about your own flesh. Think about your own disordered desires. Don't think about other people. Don't think about how this applies to someone else. Listen to what God may be saying to you about what it looks like to be at war with your flesh. That's what the flesh is in our lives. It's these disordered, animalistic cravings and desires that we have. So then the question is, so how does that lead us to sin? What's that do in us? How does that play out in our lives? I'll give a really easy example. Have you ever been in a grocery store checkout line and just had to stop and wait for a while, and so you're looking at what's just on display around you? If you do this often, you'll look, and usually on one side there's like a rack of magazines, and it'll have the kinds of National Geographic weirdness of the world kinds of fake news magazines, and then it'll have Men's Health and Cosmopolitan and things that are giving these airbrushed pictures of people and what's made them look attractive, and it's telling you how you can look just like them if you'll follow their simple workout program or their simple diet, and it's playing to this desire in you to look like something or feel like something or attain something. And then on the other side are Mike and Ike's and Snickers, gum, and every kind of candy and excess kind of junk food that there could possibly be for quick impulse. Because grocery stores know that if you have just a few extra moments, what they want to utilize those moments for is playing to your desires, to your impulses, to get you to buy something. To get you to understand you want to look like a Hemsworth brother or you want to eat a Snickers bar. And if you stop and think for a moment, you would recognize how contradictory those two sides of the aisle are. Yet they're both in our authentic fleshly self somewhere. These things that war against each other and try to play out in us. And often what ends up happening is that we grab the Snickers bar and the magazine and we eat the junk food while we read about that person's ab workout. Because our flesh just starts playing it out. As this book is talking about the flesh and the way it plays out, I want to read just some of his examples on the way it plays out, not in grocery store aisles, but on the way it plays out in our day-to-day decisions. Here's what he says about his own experience. He says, I want to love my children well and to be present as a father and to intentionally unfold them into their full potential. But I also want to close the door and watch TV. Let them sort out their own annoying problems. I want to live deeply grateful and content with what I have, as well as practice radical generosity. But I also want to buy a new jacket I don't need and upgrade my perfectly good car. I want to get up early and soak my mind in the heart and scripture and prayer. But I also want to stay up late watching The Long Way Up. We could go on for pages of this because it's the nature of the human experience. What's easy to miss in the modern view of things is that our strongest desires are not actually our deepest desires. What I mean by that is that in the moment of temptation, the raging fire of desire that is your flesh, this desire to make the condescending comment about your coworker, to buy another pair of shoes you don't need, to overeat, overdrink, lust, ignore God, watch Netflix instead of reading your Bible, it feels overwhelming and almost irresistible. But those desires are not actually the deepest, truest desires of your heart. They don't come from the bedrock layer in your soul. My guess is if you go deep enough, you ache for God himself, to live in his love and to yield to his gentle peace, to let your body become a place where his will is done on earth as it is in heaven. That's a gift of the Spirit in you. We've got these deep longings for what God would do in our lives that they're distant from sin, where sin isn't even a thought in our life, where we're living out this spirit life. God has intended us receiving from him everything he has for us and then living out of it everything he hopes for us. And yet, all too often, we live out of our flesh. Maybe the clearest place that Paul talks about the flesh is in Galatians 5 and 6. Starts this way. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. We often in America, we read this and we love this. Freedom is one of our values. Often one of our disordered values. Placed above submission, placed above obedience, our freedom goes awry. In our nation, addiction is widespread. So is compulsive shopping, debt, financial fraud, obesity, alcoholism. In fact, anything that requires long-term fidelity is currently in decline. Marriage, two-parent homes, so on. Because we love trying things that feel good in the moment. And we give up when they require long-term discipline. The statistics would say that by the end of next week, 92% of people will have given up on their New Year's resolution, not because their deep desire isn't to see it fulfilled, but because it came hard to make that decision every day. Because their flesh won and the natural instinctual desire took over again. By the end of January, only 8% of people are still making any kinds of steps towards the things they've resolved to make true in their lives. We've been given freedom. Christ gives us freedom. And yet we use it to just do whatever we want. And that's not how Jesus or Paul ever defined freedom. Freedom isn't just about nobody being able to control us. That's the American view of freedom. Scripture assumes a positive view of freedom. It's the things that we get to choose to do good. We get to free to live out our vows, free to stay committed, free to choose holiness, to choose love, to choose nonviolence, to choose to turn the other cheek, to choose to walk the extra mile, to choose to bear the burdens of other people. That's a freedom we have. We recognize that those constraints can be helpful. That's why we don't give alcohol to teenagers. They don't internally have everything ready to figure out how to have freedom in that. That's why we don't give driver's licenses to people with too many DUIs. They haven't lived internally. They're not free enough internally to being willing to choose external freedoms. Instead, most of what we call freedom, the ability to choose what we want without constraint, is what Scripture calls slavery, where we're ruled by our vices and our desires, not our restraints and our commitments, where we're ruled by our wants, where we're ruled by our animalistic instincts, and then we find ourselves devoid of intimacy because we're not willing to make commitment and live within it. Paul go on, it's a few verses later, verse 13. He says it this way, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. You've been called by God, you've been paid for by Christ to be free, but don't use your freedom simply to indulge the flesh. Simply living out your most basic animalistic desires and instincts is far from the freedom Christ hopes for us." And Paul makes that clear. And so he tells us what the opposite of that is, what it looks like instead. He continues in that verse, "Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself." Paul says if you want to fight against the animalistic desires, if you want to wage war against sin that creeps up by just doing what you want, the best way to do it, love your neighbors as yourselves. Serve other people. Stop paying attention to your own desires and start meeting other people's needs instead. Choose restraint and good in others above yourself. That's what he says is best for us. That's the opposite of living a life of the flesh, is choosing to live a life of service to other people. Paul's point, stated in a different language, is that our flesh is against love. It's for ourselves and against other people. The flesh runs off of our animal drives. It runs off of self-gratification and survival. And it sees other people either as obstacles to our flesh or as the objects of it. They're either the obstacles to our desires or the objects of it. That's what Freud said. The greatest problem in your life, if you're not happy, is that other people have become obstacles to your desires or they've become the object of your desires. And Paul says, no. The way we're supposed to live our freedom out is against the flesh, not gratifying its desires. Instead, it's to choose loving action towards others above even our own gratification. He tells us what we're supposed to do instead. He goes on to say, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what's contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want." They're at war with each other. The life of the flesh and the life of the Spirit are contrary to each other. They're in conflict with each other. They're at war with each other. Paul says, don't just do whatever you want. Just because something feels good doesn't mean it is good. If there's anything we shouldn't do, it's simply whatever we want. Quickly reorienting back to last week, that's a lie from the devil. Just do whatever you want and feels right is a lie from the devil. It's how he starts all of them. spirit and flesh are contrary to each other. And Paul tells us what each of them do in our own lives, how we can identify them, what they look like, and what they result in. Here's what he says. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. If you go down that list, you could find a popular resource for every one of those things. You want sexual immorality, impurity, and debauchery? Download Tinder. Swipe to try to find hookups. You want hatred, discord, factions? Listen to politics and make that the primary goal of your life. You want to see drunkenness and orgies? Turn on Netflix and look at the top 10 things that are being viewed. Outside of Cocomelon for kids, 9 of them are probably filled with that stuff. It's what our society is feeding us. It's what marketing is enticing us with, the envy, selfish desires. There's plenty of good in our culture around us as well, but we can't ignore the dark side. And much of what's popular in our culture is driving us not towards the spirit, but towards our flesh. It's a reality that we live in and need to be aware of. We'll talk about that as it relates to the world more next week. Paul goes on, though, to give the opposite. He says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And against such things there is no law. This is the experience of Christ. He was one who lived this out perfectly, lived out freedom more than desire. Christ lived it out expressed in his commitment and his obedience to the Father's will, and did so in a way that was then perfectly free from bondage and from slavery or from his flesh or from sin. Temptation was present, but he was able to fight against it perfectly every time because he was walking with God. He did what Paul asked us to do. Here's what he asks us to do. It's verse 24. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Have crucified the flesh. And the simple question, what are we supposed to do about our flesh? We're supposed to kill it. We're supposed to crucify it. We're supposed to make sure it has no play in our lives, that it gets no value, that it can't function. And the question often then is, so how? Here's what Paul says. It's the next chapter, Galatians chapter 6, starting in verse 7. He says, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh from the flesh will reap destruction, and whoever sows to please from the spirit will reap eternal life. If you want to do what God has asked us to do, if we want to be able to put the flesh to death, if we want to crucify it, we need to recognize that we'll reap what we sow. And so if we respond to the flesh, it's what we will reap. This bag of Mike and Ike's isn't the one from Josh's office. Last Thursday, I was going to get a goodbye gift for Cindy. One of her favorite things is Mounds candy bars, chocolate and coconut. And so I went over to Bill's on my way home on my way back to the office from a meeting to get one for her to give with a card I was going to give her. And while I was there to pick up a Mounds for Cindy, I happened to look down the aisle and see bags of Mike and Ike's. And because I had been feeding that desire for 10 days, $7 sounded really efficient to be able to have my own bag in my office. And so I bought it. I was harvesting what I had been reaping. Did you know that the opposite can happen? Last summer, I did a nutrition challenge with my gym. And it included limiting some of the kinds of junk food for a season. It wasn't like a you can't ever have sugar or anything, but it did have a how many vegetables you're supposed to eat. And I found I like some vegetables a lot, but I don't like a lot of vegetables. And so around the house and in my office, instead of handfuls of Mike and Ike's, I often had handfuls of baby tomatoes. these little grape tomato guys. They'd be present in my home, they'd be present in my desk. And when I was hungry for 12 weeks, instead of finding candy, I was finding grape tomatoes. Do you know that if you'll do that long enough, you actually lose the craving for sugar? Like, it actually starts to not even look appealing. You get like a large piece of cake with frosting all over it, and you take a bite and you just think, it's too much. I don't want it right now. That if you sow in the desires of your flesh, you'll reap that. And Paul says that's destruction. Or you can sow in the desires of your spirit, and you'll reap that. And it's eternal life. I've seen that play out in the basics of food, but the reality is it plays out everywhere. We hear it in our society. What goes around comes around. You get what you pay for. You get back what you put in. No pain, no gain. Garbage in, garbage out. It's poetic justice. Give, and it will be given to you. Well, that's Christ saying it. With the measure you use, it will be measured against you. I'm going to forgive you as you forgive others. See, God can't be mocked. What we sow will become reality. If you eat a lot of sugar, you're going to crave sugar. If you eat a lot of vegetables, you're going to crave healthy fuels for your body. If you give into the flesh and your disordered desires, it's going to take root into yourself and form your nature. But if you invest in the Spirit, it's going to take root in you and grow a Christ-like nature. As you make your daily decisions, sin can become easier through your lying, through your lusting, through your swearing, through whatever, your selfishness. Or the life of the Spirit can become easier through your praying, through the binding of your thoughts, through the way you see the world and choose to find God in it. Most people fail. This is a quote from a Dr. Eric Fromm. Most people fail in the art of living not because they're inherently bad or so without will that they can't lead a better life. They fail because they don't wake up and see when they stand at a fork in the road and they have to decide. They don't recognize that the choice they're making is shaping them. In his book, Live No Lies, John Mark Comer says it this way. Let's take a less dramatic but a far more humdrum example, like negativity. With every decision we make to complain, criticize, play the victim, or focus on the negative and so on, we become more and more like the person who is by nature negative, grouchy, unhappy, and unpleasant to be around, until eventually we lose the very capacity to live happy, grateful, and full of wonder at our lives in God's good world. But the reciprocal is true as well. The daily decision to rejoice, to cultivate a way of seeing our lives in God's good world, not through the lens of our phones, news apps, or flesh, but through gratitude, celebration, and unhurried delight, will over time form us into joyful, thankful people who deeply enjoy life with God and others. What starts as an act of the will eventually turns to our inner nature. What begins as a choice eventually becomes our character. Every thought, every desire we follow, every choice we make is an investment in our future and into the kind of people you want to become. Are you choosing the flesh or are you choosing the Spirit? Paul says, crucify the flesh and live in step with the Spirit. And while some of those choices may happen through willpower, the reality is most of it can't. Jesus says, even to his own disciples, when it comes to something like praying in the garden, that the Spirit was willing, but the flesh was weak. And so maybe willpower can work over something like Mike and Ike's or grape tomatoes, but it's unlikely to work over your past pains and traumas, your identity and where you find it, your reputation, your esteem, or your broken relationships. To win, we need access to a power that's beyond us, to the Spirit of God that works on our behalf, to Christ himself present in the Spirit that he has sent to us. This is what Paul says about it in Romans chapter 8. For what the law was powerless to do, just rules and willpower, was powerless to do it because it was weakened by the flesh. God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That's the choice we can make, to live according to the Spirit. He defines it again. Those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. We have to instead submit to the Spirit. Not to our own willpower, not to a fight we try on our own, but to the Spirit of God at work in us. Therefore, he says in verse 12, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. We need to crucify the flesh, and we put it to death by the Spirit. We said it last week, spiritual disciplines are spiritual warfare. The time and the truth, that's God's word, and in prayer, relationship with him, are what matters in our fight against these things. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, sin demands to have a man by himself. It withdraws him from the community. And the more isolated a person is, the more destructive the willpower of sin over him. Sin wants to remain unknown. It shuns the light. And in the darkness of the unexpressed, it poisons the whole being of a person. We cannot leave our flesh unchecked. One last verse before I call us to a response. James, the brother of Jesus, said it this way. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Our most basic animalistic instincts have been disordered by sin, and because of that, our flesh desires what's contrary to God. And all of us, in different degrees and in different actions, too often give our flesh the power, and too often live as if it's what's in charge. And yet what God says instead is that we need to bring sin into the light. We need to make choices not to gratify the flesh, but to crucify the flesh, and instead walk in the power of the Spirit, a gift that we receive, to choose disciplines and actions that walk by the Spirit, to fight against the flesh. And so I want to ask us to do that. I'm going to have you stand. Nathan's going to come and lead us in a song here of worship in a moment. And as you stand, I just want us to acknowledge something in our own lives. That we have a flesh. That often our flesh is played out into disordering the desires, and we've let that go into practice, and we've made choices, whether it's silly things like sugar or vegetables, which don't necessarily have an impact on our souls, but where we recognize that what we sow, we reap. Some of you may be hearing this morning, as we've been talking about the flesh and talking about our disordered desires, there's been a thought, a habit, a relationship, an action, a behavior that stuck out. It's been in the back of your mind, maybe even causing you to feel guilty or something like that. I want you to be sensitive to that. Pay attention to it. Don't just dismiss it. Don't just wallow in it either. Let's do something about it. Let's confess it. One of my favorite practices I've engaged in the last 2 months or so has been through a daily prayer app on my phone. 4 times a day, it leads me through a guided prayer and devotion time. And every one of those times, it has me pray a prayer of confession. The same prayer of confession 4 times a day. It's a prayer of confession. I'm going to ask you to pray as we respond to the sin and flesh in our own lives, as we admit what has taken root in us all too often. And while there's benefit in acknowledging it to others, let's start by acknowledging it first to God and then worshiping him for the redemption he offers. The prayer is going to come up on the screen. I'm going to read it. You can feel free to read it as a prayer with me. There's no pressure to do that. But if you've got any recognition in your own life of the flesh having ruled at some moment, maybe a simple prayer of confession you can pray. And then we will sing. Most merciful God, I confess that I have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what I have done and by what I have left undone. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved my neighbors as myself. I'm truly sorry and I humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on me and forgive me, that I may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Oh, to be like me, blessed Redeemer, this is my constant longing and prayer. Grant me I'll forfeit all of earth's treasures, Jesus, thy
As you go, I know something that's going to be a reality. Sin's going to be at war against you, and it wants control. As you leave, it wants you to make every decision to please your flesh, and to give in to the desires that feel basic and authentic, and maybe even feel true. The reality is if you want to win the war against sin, you have to crucify that flesh. So as you go today, go and make decisions to live in step with the Spirit, to walk by the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit. Make those decisions and you will reap a harvest of eternal life. We can crucify the flesh through the power of God in us as we live in His Spirit. So go with grace, go in peace, go in the power of the Spirit as you go. You are dismissed.